Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of The Fandom Optimists, the show where we talk about the latest and greatest of our favorite fandoms with a decidedly optimistic view. As always, I'm Jordan, and I am honored to be joined by one of the hosts of the show, True Believers, a comic book podcast. Andrew, welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me. I'm excited to be here. This is the first time I've ever been a guest on the show.
Thanks so much for being here. This is the first time that I've had a guest who's the host of a podcast that I wasn't already on. So
how weird how that works.
So that's pretty cool. So today we are talking mostly about Marvel's Eternals. It's just Eternals, right? Not the Eternals. I'm pretty sure it's just Eternals.
I thought it was the Eternals. I don't know.
Oh man, now you're messing with me. I gotta Google this.
I know, I was typing it in right. No, you're right. It's just Eternals.
It's just Eternals. Okay, cool. So I guess we will start with a little bit of a non-spoiler review, because I know a lot of people probably haven't had a chance to watch it. And given the reviews, a lot of people might be on the fence about whether they're going to watch it at all. So Andrew, what did you think of this? Did you like this movie?
Well, I'll start off with I was kind of on the fence with it too. There were some parts of it that I just genuinely hated, but then there was some.
So I was like,
how do I don't know. I was kind of right in the middle on this one.
Okay, interesting. So you're kind of middle of the road. My basic thought is I thought it was pretty good. There's one, without spoiling anything, there is one subplot. It accounts for, I don't know, 15 minutes of screen time that I thought was done really poorly and was really dumb. But otherwise, I thought it was pretty good. I thought the performances were great.
Oh, yeah. I agree. Yeah. I thought the acting in this was really good. Everybody had such good chemistry. The whole cast did. They looked like they genuinely liked each other, which was really cool.
Yeah, and I totally bought that this was a group of people who have known each other for thousands of years.
Yeah, they all seemed like best friends, and I don't know how long they've actually known each other. I don't know how long it took to film this, but it was really cool.
You know, they looked like best friends.
It was so interesting.
Yeah, and occasionally there'll be a moment where you're like, oh, that's almost a sibling dynamic. Sometimes they feel like a found family.
Yeah, especially with Sprite, being the child in the movie. It really felt like she was actually like their little sister almost, you know?
Yeah, very much so. I thought the performances were great. I thought it's a beautiful movie, for one. Just everything in it is really pretty.
Yes, I agree completely. The special effects, Marvel always has really good special effects. I'll always give them credit for that, even if sometimes their movies are a miss, but they always look visually great.
Yeah, top of the line. Chloe Zhao's direction here is also interesting for the MCU.
Yeah, I think that's one of the parts that I didn't actually like. I don't know if this was her. I have this weird theory that Disney tells directors what they're allowed to do in movies. And I think that the directors just kind of have to do it. You know what I mean? And
yeah,
I feel like this was one of those times too. But, I can't verify that. There's just a weird conspiracy theory I've always believed in.
That would not surprise me at all. Because they all do tend to have, and I hate using this word, a kind of a bland a look to a lot of them. I mean, there's always standouts. In every Marvel movie, there's a few just epic moments where, this is the prettiest thing I've ever seen. But, I think I know what you're talking about there. Let's see. What else can I say about it that's good or bad without spoiling anything?
Because the costuming was amazing in this. I loved all.
Oh, good. Every single one of them.
Yeah, incredible costume work. And the plot, to me, the main plot works really well. I was thoroughly engaged. It's just this side plot that I just really hated the side plot, but I really liked the main one.
I don't know if this is spoilers or not, but I hate flashbacks so much in movies, and that's what I hate the most about Marvel/Disney. And
I was like, oh my god.
That's one of the biggest things I hated.
That's fair. And for anyone wondering, this movie, every other scene where you're going to flash back a couple thousand years to something that happened a long time ago.
Yeah, they had thousands of years of flashback.
So yeah, that's fair. If you're not a flashback type person, I can see that annoying you a lot.
It did, yeah.
Okay, I think partly because there's just a lot of stuff that I want to talk about that I don't want to. So anyway, so I guess we'll stop the non-spoilers here. My vote, if it's safe for you to go see it, and you know you feel like spending some money, it's worth seeing. It's not a bad movie. A lot of people are calling it a bad movie. I'm not seeing that.
I agree. It's a very enjoyable movie, even if I just said that I hated some parts. It's still very enjoyable overall. And I think...
it is definitely the kind of thing where if it's safe for you to go see it, go see it. Obviously, if it's not safe, don't do that. Just watch Shang-Chi on Disney Plus instead. Because it's out now. And that's really cool. Okay, we'll jump into full-on spoilers right here. This is your cue to click off and come back after you've seen the movie if you think you're gonna go see it. If you just don't care about spoilers, I guess stick around. It's up to you. So you say you hated some parts of this.
Yes. Okay. I want to know what you were going to say, though. What was the subplot that you couldn't stay in? I'm really interested in this.
Yeah. So for me, it was the smart deviant. That I don't get it. I don't get why it's significant. So in case you have stuck around and you don't care about spoilers, there is a plot in this movie where one of the deviants who I believed were going to be the main villain of the movie, I'm kind of glad that they sort of weren't. But one of them occasionally like absorbs an Eternal's power and gets smarter and more humanoid. And that just kind of doesn't go anywhere. It just sort of happens. Yeah, and it's weird.
No sense. But I actually enjoyed it.
I wanted to see him
get more and more human, but I was like, that means more people are going to die.
Oh, yeah.
Also, I've never seen so many like main characters die in a Disney movie. I was.
Oh, that's true. Unless you're counting Infinity War, not really. We all knew that wasn't gonna stick. So I guess unless we're counting that, yeah, this was a lot of dead characters. Did they just kill, how many of them? They killed two of the Eternals.
Yeah, they killed at least Ajak and Gilgamesh, so.
Yeah, so they killed, they killed three of them, right? They killed Ajak and Gilgamesh, and then Icarus.
Did Icarus? No, he just flew off in the end, didn't he? I don't think he died.
I thought he flew into the sun to kill himself.
Okay, see, I kind of thought that was what he was going for, but then there's Hyperion in the comic books also, who like can sometimes absorb the sun to get more powerful, and I think that was supposed to be a hint towards that later on, but I can't confirm that because the MCU does weird shit.
Man, and they even mention his Superman parallels during the movie, and that never occurred to me as being a possibility that he was just going to go charge up in the sun or something.
I don't know if they know that they can do that, but I just...
I should have known, like,
hindsight, but Hyperion is also an Eternal, so I was like, is this supposed to be a hint towards him? I don't really know.
Wait, Hyperion's an Eternal in the comics?
I actually just Googled it. That's how I figured it out. But I was sitting there and I was reading something, and then I was like, wait a minute. And then I like Googled it to make sure, and then I was like, oh my god, he's an Eternal.
That's cool. I never knew he was an Eternal. I want to see Hyperion in one of these movies. I specifically want to see Hyperion played by Henry Cavill because I think it would be really funny.
Cool, like, hint towards both
universes.
Yeah, especially since the, you know, Hyperion and the Squadron Supreme are just evil Justice League. It would be really funny if you got some of the Justice League actors to show up for that.
What if Icarus came back as like the Squadron Supreme leader? That would be...
I never know what they're gonna do. Yeah, who knows? It would be cool. I thought he was just distraught and he killed himself, which is why I left the theater thinking this is the darkest Marvel movie. Because I'm like, we had a suicide on screen in a Marvel movie. This is intense.
And we had sex in this movie. Like,
yeah,
this took it up a level.
Everyone calls it the first sex scene. I guess it's the first, like, I guess it's the first we see. I guess, do we see his back? We see clothless. I guess it's the first clothless sex scene, but Iron Man had a sex scene in the first, like, 10 minutes.
yeah.
Real short. So I guess maybe people aren't counting that. And they're calling this the first one.
This one was the most explicit, I think, so far. By far.
Yeah, and it lasted a little bit longer than the Iron Man one. True. That's true.
Did you see at the beginning, like, in the... You know how, like, it tells you it's PG-13 and why it's rated PG-13 and whatever?
Mm-hmm.
There was a thing that said, like, offensive language or something like that. Or, like, I can't remember. And it was so funny to me. I don't know why. And then you see Sprite flipping him off. I was like, is that the offensive language?
I guess. That's
because they don't say anything.
I can't think of anything else that it could have been.
Yeah, it was insane. I was sitting there. I don't know why that stuck with me the whole movie. I was sitting there waiting to see what this offensive language was going to be. And I think Sprite was it.
Interesting. I guess so. But yeah, no idea. But yeah, so the smart deviant, I thought that was dumb and pointless. And with the exception of that, I really liked pretty much everything else in this movie. So I'm intrigued to hear what didn't work for you.
Well, on the deviant note, I kind of thought that he was going to be Crow from the comics. And I kept saying that to my co-host who went with me, Chris.
I think he is. I'm pretty sure he is. I think the credits named him as Crow.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
They just never said it. They just never said it anywhere in the movie. It was in the credits.
Oh, that's so dumb. Just to kill him off, too.
I know. It's like some shooting Jimmy Olsen at the beginning of a movie kind of level stuff.
One of my biggest problems with this movie, though, was like how they did Dina was such a weird thing. Like, why were they making her... Like, you could have easily left that whole part out, right? Just making her go crazy because she sees her past memories or whatever.
And it was kind of out of nowhere to the extent that I was real confused until like an hour after it happened. And they're like, oh, it's because this. I was like, oh, okay. I guess I get it, but it's weird.
Yeah, I hated it. I hated watching that. I was like, what is the point of this at all? And then I was thinking about it right before we started recording, you know, and I was like, they really could have just left that entire storyline out. Also, the way that they told the story was kind of odd to me. I didn't like how they were telling it. I don't even know how to explain it. I just hated like how it wasn't very fluid, you know, the storytelling. It was kind of all over the place.
Yeah, I've heard that complaint a lot, and the more I think about it, the more I'm like, man, I do agree with it, but then when I go through the movie and think about, well, what if we rearranged this, and then I'm like, nah, that wouldn't work, because then you lose, you know, this, because I remember someone pitched you should tell it in chronological order and show us Icarus learning about the true mission and leaving Cersei. I'm like, but then you don't get blindsided by him being super nice to everyone the whole movie, only to turn out that he's kind of just distracting them.
Yeah, you know, that was actually a plot twist I saw coming too. Like,
really? I did not.
Yeah. I told Chris who
was with me, I was like, okay, yeah, he's going to kill Ajax, and like, he's behind all of this. Like, as soon as we saw Ajax's body, I was like, oh, this motherfucker right here.
Wow, that's amazing.
So I was so disappointed that I was right.
That's impressive. I did not clock that at all. I was just like, oh yeah, Icarus, he's basically Superman. This is fun. He's my favorite character. He turned out real bad.
Yeah, that's why my old roommate hates watching movies with me, is because I'll figure out the ending really quick and then I'll say it and then she gets mad at me. But
yeah, that's always fun though. I find it's really fun to watch with someone like that, and then I'm like, because I never believe it, and I'm like, you're wrong. It's not going to be that, and then you're right anyway.
Yeah, it hurts when you're right sometimes. Like, one thing though, I love the inclusion in this movie of like so many different variety of people. You know, I thought that was amazing. I didn't even care that they weren't as comic book accurate as they could have been.
The diversity of it was really cool. I liked seeing. I think my favorite character in this, it was gonna be Icarus until he turned out to be an asshole, but I think my favorite character is Festus. I really like him.
Me too. He came in really kind of late in the movie too. I just not thought about that.
Oh, that's a good point. He didn't really have a substantial impact. Like, they had a little bit with him talking about, I'm going to give them a steam engine. And they're like, no, don't give them a steam engine. That's too far ahead. He goes, all right, fine. The plow.
That part was funny.
That was good. He had all my favorite humorous moments, other than Kumail Nanjiani, Kingo.
Oh my god, yes, he was hilarious when he was the Bollywood star. That was, so funny.
I was cracking up the whole, just every facial expression, everything he's doing there, it's great.
When he first comes on scene and is doing the musical number, I was like, what the fuck is happening right now?
it really cracks me up that he's been pretending to be multiple generations of men in his family.
I know, how do you get away with that?
It's really funny. And he apparently does it pretty rapidly, too, because I guess if this has all been movie careers, then he's been four different people in 100 years.
Right. That's pretty impressive. Like, that's a skill right there.
Yeah, he's jumping real fast. He's making these people think that he dies really quickly, I guess. And then his son takes over takes on the mantle.
Yeah, four generations of it.
Him having his valet record a documentary was the funniest thing.
I know. That, you know, Marvel, I just realized this too. Like, Marvel does all these weird little side characters like that for, like, the comedic effect, and that always steals the show. Like, they've had him in all the past few movies, like Shang-Chi and Spider-Man, like, all of them.
Yeah, there's always a silly comic relief character, I think. Because for Thor movies, I guess it's Darcy.
Oh, yeah, and yeah.
if you go back to Iron Man, I guess it's Happy in Iron Man 2 and 3. It's probably Happy Hogan. In the first Iron Man, it's just that Tony's really funny. So I don't think they needed a wacky comic relief character for that. But yeah, they usually, like, they had Luis for Ant-Man. They had, it was always a fun side character. What was this guy's name again? The valet?
Oh, I have no idea. I should know that.
It has slipped my mind. I guess it's because my memory is already a little stretched to make sure I remember all 10 Eternals, that I didn't have room for the comic relief side character. I was worried that I was not going to remember all of the, because, you know, I did not benefit from listening to your Eternals episode before I saw the movie. But yeah, so I was like, oh no, 10 new superheroes. I don't know if I'm going to be able to remember this, but it was surprisingly easy because they were so engaging. I wound up remembering all of them.
I agree. Who was your favorite one?
You
already said that. You said it was Fastos.
it's between Fastos and Kingo. But Kingo leaves, and that bothered me.
Yeah, I didn't understand the point of that.
He just walks out. I guess I kind of like it from a sort of real world philosophical level of him saying, look, I'm sticking with my belief, but I'm not going to hurt you guys for it. I refuse to hurt you guys for my beliefs. So I'm just going to remove myself from this. I thought that was pretty cool.
True.
It's like
noble
action there, but I really wish you'd help.
Yeah. Okay, so I do like how they did the Unimind at the end. Like, that was a good, like, a modern...
That kind of fit the movie, because
I think the Unimind in the comics is one of the dumbest things I've ever read. So that they actually did that well is pretty impressive.
Yeah. Oh, I thought it was really cool. Cersei being able to turn a celestial to stone was pretty intense.
Like, visually stunning
part too. Like, the special effects were just out there with that.
Yeah, it was insane. Oh, this movie also, before I forget, has, I think, my new favorite speedster moment. I don't know, it's tough. I really did like the Flash rewinding the destruction of Earth in Zack Snyder's Justice League. I thought that was really cool, but I think Makari might be cooler, because the scene where she's just hitting Icarus from every possible angle was just so cool to me that I was like, that's one of the cooler speedster things I've ever seen.
I know. She was just beating the shit out of, quote-unquote, the most powerful Eternal. I was like, holy shit, it was so good.
And that it was unique. They didn't rely on pretty much any other speedster effect. They just kind of went with this new direction. It really worked. And they didn't use bullet time. I like bullet time, but I'm tired of bullet time.
Yeah, I was going to say that that is kind of overdone. But I do like how they had, like, each Eternal had kind of, like, a mystical, but, like, electronic-y kind of power-y thing.
Original unique.
Because they've done so much magic in the MCU at this point, so the fact that they keep making it unique is kind of impressive.
Yeah, that's a good point. I really thought that was cool. Also, on the note of kind of mystic, but sort of technology-ish, the score... Raman Djawadi's score is awesome. It feels kind of biblical almost, like it just in the sense that it feels very ancient and mythological, but yeah, also kind of high tech in places. It's appropriate. It fits really well. Mm-hmm. I listened to a bit of the soundtrack before seeing the movie, and I was like, oh, I don't know, this soundtrack sounds weird. But then I watched it in the movie. I was like, oh, I get it now. This fits perfectly.
I agree. That was one of the first things I said to Chris when we left was, like, the music and
for every scene it was in.
It was kind of amazing how they did that, too. These are all the things that I love, obviously.
Yeah. What else? While I'm thinking of other things. What was some of the stuff that you really didn't like about this movie, other than the, that they could have cut the Medwiri thing?
Yeah, the Athena thing was, like, my biggest pet peeve. But this is just something that really bothered me, is that, like, why couldn't anyone else fly, you know? They're all in the comic books pre-Neil Gaiman in 2007. They all had the same powers, but nobody could fly in this. Also, Circe could only change non-animate objects. I was like, that's not right. Like, they depowered her, like, crazy in this.
Yeah, that's fair. It's kind of the problem you inherently run into when you have these god-level beings that are pretty unstoppable.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the fact that they could also die, because the Eternals can't die in the comic books, that's just
interesting.
So the fact that they could die also depowered them, but I was like, I guess you can't have creatures this powerful in the MCU. Like, they hold too much weight, you know?
Yeah, I also think it's kind of smart that they sort of... Because I don't know if we'd get, I guess now I'm thinking forward. I don't know if we would get an Eternals 2 or what, because they did an interesting thing with splitting up the Eternals at the end, where we've got some of them are going off to find Eternals somewhere else, and some of them are going to be judged by Arishem.
Ooh, okay, see, I did like that part, that they're being judged by Arishem, but it did say the Eternals will return, so I don't know how they're going to bring them back.
Yeah, I'm hoping they just kind of turn up in a variety of other stuff. But I wouldn't mind an Eternals 2 either. That would be pretty exciting.
I don't know. I have a theory that Druig is going to come back as the villain, because he's the villain in the comics. So I think they're going to do like a Doctor Strange thing, how they made Baron Mordo the villain towards the end in like a post-credit scene, you know what I mean?
Yeah, oh, that would be cool.
I feel like that's...
villain.
He even looked like a villain half of the movie. I was like, he's not fooling anyone.
Yes. I loved his performance, but yeah, I didn't know anything about the comics for the Eternals, like not a single thing, except that all I knew about the Eternals going into this movie is they were created by the Celestials to fight the Deviants. That's it. That's all I know. That's all I knew about them. But from the trailer, I was like, man, Druig looks like an asshole. I think he's gonna be the traitor. So that like led to me having absolutely no clue that the Icarus twist was coming.
Oh, also, speaking of Druig, it's like if their whole purpose is to just kind of almost farm humans, you know, with his power he could have easily populated the earth a lot quicker. So it was like, yeah. I feel like they're not doing
it's gonna be done by now.
Yeah, it's a bit. This does have one of those plots where if you start thinking about it, it just kind of doesn't make a lot of sense. But
I just thought of that right now.
But I'm a big fan of not thinking about things so that I don't have to confront that they don't make sense. I always get criticized online for that. People are like, well, you just want to shut your brain off and like things. And my response is always, if I have to shut my brain off to like something, I will, because I want to like it.
Yeah, well, what's wrong with liking things?
I like to like things. That's why I named the show The Fandom Optimist.
Same.
It's all about, yeah. And you know, because I always get, I get a question about this every now and then. Fandom optimists, I don't mean that we're going to blindly praise everything. I just mean we don't have any negativity in our hearts when we review these things.
That's how I feel about the original X-Men trilogy, you know, with Hugh Jackman and Famke Janssen.
Yes!
But, like, those aren't good movies, but I will die that those are my favorite movies.
I love them. They're great.
You're right. It's okay. Just turn your brain off. It doesn't have to make sense.
Okay, let's see. What else is there to say about the Eternals? Positive or negative? What else is to say? The effect of Arishem, I got to see it on in an XD theater, which is kind of IMAX ish and man, seeing Arishem, I was like, oh it's big, it's real big. It made a cool effect.
They were literally just dots next to him, like, how big is this guy?
Yeah,
he's fucking huge.
Yeah, I like that when they first show him, they're showing like an 1.5 of his eyes.
I know. They're literally the size, not even the size of his eye, like just a speck next to it. It's crazy how big that thing is. So hopefully he never really comes to Earth, because, you know, he did at the end a little bit. But
yeah,
hopefully they never really have to deal with him. But I didn't understand how he was wrong. You know what? He was just doing what he's supposed to be doing. So I was like, I don't think he's really that much of a villain, guys.
Yeah, this movie does have a very interesting... It's other than... Honestly, Ant-Man and the Wasp gets a lot of flack, but it's the only other Marvel movie I can think of that does this, where I really don't know who the villain is. There's kind of an antagonist, but otherwise everyone seems pretty justified from their perspective.
Except the Deviants.
Well, not even, because they were just doing what they kind of evolved to do, so
not yeah,
even the
they're
Deviants
just,
were bad.
They're just trying to live.
Right. Huh. Except Icarus. Fuck Icarus.
Yeah. But yeah, like, because much like with Ant-Man and the Wasp, you know, you spend the whole movie thinking, oh, Ghost is the villain, and then you kind of realize, oh, she's just in agonizing pain and she's just desperately trying to heal herself. She's not really got any particularly malicious objective here. And then when you get to the end of it and Michelle Pfeiffer just kind of helps her, I forgot her name. Forgot Janet. Michelle Pfeiffer first. But, you know, that movie just kind of has where Ghost is sort of a hindrance on the objective of the movie, but not really a villain. And that's pretty rare. And this is kind of the second time I've seen that, where it's like, I guess Kingo and really partly Icarus, but I mean, Icarus is a dick, so I don't really want to, and I really don't really want to stand up for him. But I get where Kingo is like, well, if we do this, we're preventing billions of lives from being created somewhere else. It's an interesting concept.
Right. And Arishem can't really be the villain either, because he still let them live at the, like, he could have easily destroyed the world, you know?
So it's not like he really
did anything wrong.
Yeah. I do really like that about this movie. It makes it feel kind of unique.
Yeah, there's a lot of ambiguity going on there.
Yeah, and they killed a baby Celestial.
Right. He didn't do anything. Like, he was just trying to be born.
I like to think, because they mentioned that Tiamat was like connected to their Unimind.
Mm-hmm.
I think they said that. Does that mean he was like cool with this, that he's like, yeah, I think I get what you guys are doing, and I agree, I, you know, I'm willing to die to not destroy this planet. I wonder if that was the intention of that. I like to think
I that think he was cool. That's a good it. thought. But you know, in the comics, in the Neil Gaiman run in 2007, they also can connect to the Celestial's mind, and I don't think the Celestial, they're too far advanced to even really know what's happening. Like, we're just kind of a grain of salt next to them, you know? Like, we're not really anything. So I don't think that they really understood. He was just kind of giving them his power. But...
Okay.
I like your idea better, honestly.
Yeah, it's a fun way to look at it. It's certainly certainly I'll sleep better at night thinking of it that way. Because yeah, I feel kind of bad for Tiamat otherwise.
I don't know. I feel like I had something else I wanted to say about this, but I can't remember now.
Let's see. We've got Dane. Dane is great. Kit Harington, awesome. The movie deliberately gave a sort of pause for applause moment when what's his name? Madden?
Richard Madden.
Richard Icarus. Madden and Kit Harington come face to face for a brief moment.
Oh, I know.
There was like a 3 second too long beat of like, we know what you're thinking. We know it's the Game of Thrones boys. You can applaud now. Okay, now we'll go back.
The whole theater just laughed whenever
that happened.
Yeah, I heard some chuckles.
Oh man, it was actually Ajax. That's what I wanted to say. They really threw me off with Ajax. I didn't like, based on the trailers and everything leading up to it, I thought she was gonna be, you know, the leader of the Eternals. But just to kill her off within 20 minutes, I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah. Oh, and there is one of those situations where I agree with you that maybe the ordering or the just something about the way they told this was a little bit off, because when we go find the dead body of Ajax, I was like, okay, I didn't really know her, so sure.
Right, yeah, it's hard to feel bad for her when you only met her in a flashback once.
Yeah, it's like I can tell that Cersei is sad and I like Cersei, so I guess I'll be sad, but okay.
Yeah, and they did that with Sprite too. Sprite was like, this is the last time I've seen her, and is making an illusion, and it's like, okay, but we didn't really know Ajax. We can't connect with this, you know?
Yeah, that was a bit off. It was cool to have Salma Hayek in this, though. I like that she was here.
Oh, I love Salma Hayek. I hope she comes back, because, you know, the Eternals, if they do die, can come back in the comics, so hopefully she'll come back, because we needed
more
of her.
And they did mention that all their memories are stored somewhere, and they can go
make
another one.
Oh, that's a good point. Yeah, so why can't she come back?
I hope she does. That would be pretty cool.
And Gilgamesh too.
I remember loosely hearing, like in passing a year ago, or maybe more, that Kit Harington would be playing the Black Knight. And I was like, oh, that's cool. I don't really know anything about the Black Knight, but that's cool. So because I don't know anything about the Black Knight, I had completely forgotten that by the time I saw the movie. And I remember the sort of where he gets the ring and he goes, oh, this is medieval and it's got my family crest. I'm like, that's an odd amount of backstory to give this random side character. Like, didn't click to me that might actually be important.
Oh my God. I didn't even think about that either. I knew he was the Black Knight. I didn't think about that. You just blew my mind a little bit.
Yeah, and then she calls him and she's basically telling him that, you know, the world's gonna end and you should, you know, set your affairs in order, basically. But she's telling him you should make amends with your uncle. I know you regret that that y'all don't talk. And I was like, again, an odd level of backstory to give this random character. Who is this? And it was like not connecting at all that this is a significant Marvel character.
I knew it was Black Knight and I still didn't put those together.
Gosh.
Angelina Jolie on the ship, she finds the emerald sword, and I was like, oh, Kit Harington's gonna find that later on. And that's when I finally put it together way late. So.
Yeah. I it only clicked for me at the very end when he says, well, my family history is pretty complicated. I was like, oh, wait, shit, yeah, he's going to be the Black Knight. Now I remember.
You know, better late than never.
It took until that moment. Also, partly because I don't know anything about them from the comics, it took me about two-thirds of the way through the movie to be like, oh, Festus is Hephaestus. Oh, I get it.
Yeah, and they're all like...
like, I connected with, I was like, okay, Cersei, Icarus, Thena, I get it. Gilgamesh, very cool. And I was like, Druid, I guess like a druid sprite, that makes sense, the little one, okay. But then I was like, Festos and Makari, no idea, no connection. Until like two-thirds of the way, and I was like, oh, it's Hephaestus and Mercury, I get it. That's okay, that's clever, you got me.
You got me. Did you see the little, obviously you saw it. It was like a big thing. Whenever they made the reference to Peter Pan, I loved that because in the comic books, there's like, they reference Sprite being Peter Pan too. And I was like, this is a nice little touch to you to
it. Oh, that's cool. Yeah, I love that they did the Peter Pan. See, I was just like, I didn't know that. So I did. That's a level of appreciation for that I did not previously have. I love that they made a reference to that. That was pretty cool.
It was cool.
Like, yeah, I'm Peter Pan.
Like, I can't remember who wrote Peter Pan off the top of my head, but he's like, yeah, back in the day, I convinced him that I'm Peter Pan. Sprite says that in the comic book. So when it happened here, I was like, this is so cool. Like,
that's very cool. I like that they threw that in.
I know there's another reference later on that I can't remember off the top of my head, but it's like a direct reference
with Sprite
becoming a person.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, because Sprite becomes a human in, again, the Neil Gaiman run. So.
Yeah, I got to listen to your Eternals, explanation episode after I saw the movie. So I was like, oh, that's cool. Like, the whole episode, I was just catching stuff. And I was like, oh, that's they got that from the Neil Gaiman run, too. That's awesome. That was pretty cool. It was cool to discover a bunch of comic stuff via that episode after watching the movie and realizing where it all came from.
Oh, well, I'm glad that was actually good.
Yeah, it's a helpful thing. Dear listener, if you want to like brush up on Eternals history, whether you've seen the movie or not, go check out it's now the second most recent episode of True Believers, a comic book podcast.
Yes.
Yeah, that was cool. Okay, where else can we go with the Eternals? I'm kind of wanting to drift into post-credit scenes, but I don't want to leave anything behind.
Oh, quickly, Lauren Ridloff as Makari was like a great twist. Having like a
boy
in the comic books, I thought this was such a cool little thing. I wasn't even mad that they changed the character. I'm all about the representation, but it's just, I loved her.
Yeah, I loved having. I loved having that representation in there. That was really cool. And she was so charismatic. Her presence was wonderful. Every time she was on screen, I was like, oh, that's cool. She's great.
She also came in really late too. You know, she came in towards the end of the movie.
Yeah. She's just chilling in the ship waiting to go on.
Can you imagine? That's such a boring existence, but she had like Twinkies and stuff on board. So, you know,
yeah, I guess she's been speedstering out and just grabbing stuff and going back.
I saw this thing on Twitter that said that Lauren Ridloff said that Makari is faster than the Flash, and I was like, I wonder if that's true.
Mm.
Like, I wonder.
Okay, well, based on what we saw in the movie, no. But I don't know. I don't know the comic history, so maybe.
Maybe.
You know, but based on...
The comics he creates
like machines that move fast. So,
oh, interesting.
Yeah, so that was also another little twist that they changed, which I didn't mind.
Okay, well, based on the movie, I don't think she's faster than the Flash. Just because we never see her go, you know, like above light speed.
Right.
I guess it depends on which Flash, though, because the CW True. Flash usually doesn't look all that fast either compared to like comic book Flash. Because comic book Flash is absurd.
Yeah, he can run
through time.
Like, yeah, I think I commented that on the article that was saying that she said that she's faster than the Flash, and I just commented, just to be clear, the Flash is so fast he can punch you yesterday. So let's take that into account.
Look at us, we're on the same page.
yeah, the Flash. Oh. I would love to see that buddy cop movie, though. The Flash and Makari.
That would be interesting.
That would be real fun. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, I'm surprised I didn't make a reference to The Flash with Makari there, because all the Superman references was obvious. But
yeah, they did Superman and they did Batman. I can't believe a Marvel movie did two explicit DC references in the same movie.
How was bold. Get away with that?
That was bold. He called him Alfred. That was awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man. See, this movie has some really good moments, which I think overall is why everybody should go see this. But
Yeah, the moments are what makes it, and then it's got that one really pointless side plot. I guess kind of upside a pointless side plot and a half, because I did like the way that the Medweary thing ties in, where it's like, oh, it's her past memories, because we realize this after we find out that they've had their memories wiped like thousands of times. It kind of lent to the really unsettling dark twist of it all, but it also just kind of felt shoehorned in at the same time. It's weird. It was a weird plot.
Yeah, it's also the reason that Gilgamesh died, because
hiding behind a tree
to like save him. Like, she could have killed that deviant.
Yeah, know? That was sad. I like Gilgamesh.
Me too. He was only on the screen.
Also quick.
Also, my favorite Kingo line is when he says something like, I think he says, I knew Thor as a child or something. Like,
oh, is that what
he said? He says, I knew Thor growing up or something like that. And he says, but now he's a famous Avenger and won't return my calls. And I'm like, that's so funny. And it makes me really want Kingo to show up in Thor 4.
Oh my god. Even as like a flashback, you know, Marvel loves flashbacks.
I need to see Hemsworth and Kumail Nanjiani's chemistry on screen. I bet it's great because they both seem really fun.
That's true. Yeah. That would be amazing.
So I guess we'll touch on some post-credit stuff. So I'm not like a big Harry Styles guy.
Oh, thank God you said it.
I'm not a big Harry Styles. I recognize him. But when he walked out of the shadows in the post-credit scene, first we get Pip the Troll comes out, and he's voiced by Patton Oswalt, which I thought was great. I love Patton Oswalt. And he's given this big, grand introduction, and then out of the shadows walks Harry Styles, and my whole audience, people are like, oh my god, it's him, it's Harry Styles, can you believe that? It was pretty fun to listen to everyone clamoring about Harry Styles.
Yeah, I'm not a big Harry Styles fan either, but I was kind of like, okay, but then I was like, oh, he can actually, like, this might actually be interesting. He was putting forth a lot of character to that. I didn't know he could really act, you know?
Yeah, so he's got the right presence for it. I was like, he walked in, I'm like, yeah, sure, gotta love, I'm in. Okay.
Yeah. But now I'm kind of feeling it. I was like, all right, let's see what you can do, Harry Styles.
Yeah. Oh, I'm so excited to see this polar opposite of Thanos. I'm a little bit confused about how if they're still going with this is the brother of Thanos and this guy's an Eternal, then Thanos is an Eternal or a deviant or something. And then I don't get why the Eternals didn't help deal with Thanos.
Yeah, right, because they said something along the lines of, we can only help if there's deviants, like, we're only here to stop deviants or something like that.
Yeah, but and so I was like, oh, okay, so they've done away with the comics thing about Thanos being part deviant or whatever. And but then this, maybe they didn't get rid of it because Eros is still his brother and Eros is an Eternal. I'm confused.
I don't know, was a newer story about Thanos being half Eternal, half deviant, so I was like, maybe they just don't want to get involved because he's a or an Eternal. I really don't know. Maybe they'll explain it later.
I think I heard Eric Voss over at New Rockstars said that if Thanos is an Eternal, then perhaps he knows about the Celestial plans, and him wiping half of all life was to prevent these Celestials from being born and destroying all these planets. And I'm like, wait, so then that makes him, like, objectively the protagonist of this movie. And that makes me really confused about my morality, if that's the case.
You can't say Thanos was right. That's kind of bad.
I know, it's like, you can't say he was right, but then it's like, man, if he was just trying to do the same thing, the same end result that the Eternals were trying to do, but he was doing it in a worse way, and we beheaded him. That's pretty brutal.
We beheaded him.
This is all very confusing. That is the one thing that I will say about where Marvel is going, is they are getting so big brain cosmic Marvel now that it's all getting a little confusing.
Yeah, they're getting... Who's in Loki? There was a big one in Loki.
Was it Kang? Are we talking about how we're going for Kang
coming in?
Yeah. And then something, I heard a rumor about this. I don't really know, but something about Galactus might be coming, and now we have the Celestials. I was like, this is a lot of power coming in. Like, you don't have to wait behind this.
We're kind of going in, and we're going off in a multiverse direction over in Strangeland.
Yeah, I don't know.
Man, how many different threads have we opened in Phase 4? It's terrifying.
Yeah, see, that's what I was thinking earlier when I saw it on Twitter. I was like, they're adding a lot to the MCU right now. There's like more characters and shows now, and then all these characters like the Eternals and the mo new movies that are coming out. I was like, this is a lot to be throwing at people.
Yeah, I have full faith in Marvel. I'm not at all concerned about all these different directions, but I'm fascinated by how different these directions are because we've got Strange is going off in the multiverse direction and might be dragging Spider-Man with him. And we've got the Eternals going off in this super cosmic Celestials direction. But then we've got also from the Eternals Kit Harington going on his weird mystic Black Knight direction. And we've also got the Kang stuff maybe coming in. This is nuts.
Yeah, and whatever Wanda's doing, that bitch is always acting up. So who knows what she's gonna
Oh,
do?
she's about to wreck shop. I don't know where
I
she's
know.
going next, but something terrible is gonna happen.
I know. So who knows what she's probably gonna open some weird doorway. I don't know.
Yeah, she's gonna cut loose Mephisto. And
Oh, that would be insane. Have we already had Dormammu? But Dormammu kind of sucked in Doctor Strange. Sorry, if that's
yeah,
offensive.
they could have used him better. Oh yeah, so have you heard the I think confirmation of who the voice was at the very end of the post-credit scene of Eternals with Kit Harington?
Was it after the Kit Harington post credit scene?
It was like at the very end of that, where he's got the sword and he's kind of looking at it, and that sword is like alive-ish. It's weird.
Oh
It's
yeah.
the Ebony Blade, right?
Yes, the Ebony Blade or Excalibur, as Tina said.
Okay.
But no, I don't think I saw that.
Yeah, and
Or
so
I don't recognize it.
it's kind of alive, but then you hear a voice from off screen say, "Are you sure you're ready for this, Mr. Whitman?"
Oh, I do remember that. Yeah, okay. Now, who was the voice?
I'm like 90% on this. I'm pretty sure I saw that Chloe Zhao confirmed that it is Mahershala Ali making his
Oh.
debut voice appearance as Blade. And
Yeah, okay.
oh boy, if we're going that route, if that's how we just threw Blade in here casually at the very end of an Eternals movie,
It's a
wow.
weird way to go about it, but it's smart because I did see it confirmed on Twitter, like right before we started recording, that he is going to be Blade. So,
Yeah, Mahershala Ali will be Blade. And I'm pretty excited if this means we're going to see the Black Knight hanging out with Blade hunting vampires.
would be such a weird train of events, but I'm with that.
They have abruptly made two vampire references in the MCU just in Phase 4. Like, no one's ever really mentioned vampires before, but in Loki, Owen Wilson mentions that they've captured a vampire before. And then Kingo says that when he first showed up, his valet thought he was a vampire.
Yeah.
And I'm like, interesting. We're starting to pay, and we've got Morbius coming up that may or may not be set in the MCU. I don't know. It's weird. The Morbius trailer
Yeah.
confused me a lot.
Yeah. I don't want to say anything. But you might be onto something here. I didn't put any of this together. It's like changing my life over here right now.
Yeah, I'm constantly in full-blown conspiracy theory mode about all of the movies and shows and all the connections and everything.
I mean, you're probably right. Marvel does things like this all the time, so you're probably right.
Yeah, where they're like, here's a subtle thing, and next time it's gonna be insane.
Yeah, in 10 years, this will actually mean something.
It's Avengers 7 is the Avengers fight Dracula and his army of vampires. And they need Blade and Kit Harington to come back and help out.
would be so. I mean,
They're doing Marvel
Marvel zombies,
zombies.
so what's to stop vampires?
Yeah, I guess, yeah, let's talk some of these Disney Plus announcements for a little news segment before we close out. Actually, I guess before we do that, do you have any closing thoughts on the Eternals? Because I'm out of stuff to say.
Overall, this movie was really good, so everybody should see it. But I don't think I have any more things.
All right, cool.
Oh, Cersei looked amazing the whole time. Like, that green was so pretty. But
it's so good. Yeah, I think she had the best look. I think she did. That green was really cool. Okay, let's do some news, because I don't usually have a news section on these episodes, but we have news, so I want to do one, because they announced, like you just said, they're doing an entire animated Marvel Zombies show. That's cool.
Did you like the What If episode with the zombies?
Okay, so the disclaimer is, it was my least favorite episode of What If, but that doesn't say much, because I loved What If. And, you know, that's why I always say, it's like, yeah, Thor 2 is my least favorite Marvel movie, but I still rewatch it like once a year and really like it. So it's my least favorite of anything Marvel is effectively meaningless, because it's still really good. Yeah, I'm excited. I liked it enough that I'm excited for it.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, that was actually my least favorite too. That's what I was asking you. I was yes. We'll see what happens there. Because that's the only one that didn't like really kind of tie into the series finale of the first season. So I was like, obviously they're doing something with this later on. And now here we go.
Yeah, it tied today. In a bit, in that they just dump a bunch of zombies on Ultron at some point.
Yeah, but that was like the only...
That was it.
They're even making... Okay, I just pulled it up, actually. So here's what's coming out. Mm-hmm. Is X-Men 97... Which I don't trust Disney's. So they have that, Moon Knight, She-Hulk, Miss Marvel, What If Season 2, Echo, Spider-Man Freshman Year, I Am Groot, Ironheart, Agatha, Marvel Zombies, and The Secret Invasion.
Ooh. I think a lot. Like half of those we already knew about, but the other half.
Yeah, Echo was a weird one, I thought.
Yeah, do you know much about, because I'm not really a big, what's funny is I'm a big DC Comics guy, but I'm not very well versed in the lore of Marvel Comics.
If I remember, Echo is a mutant who, I can't remember who her father is. It might have been Kingpin.
Ooh, interesting. I think. Very interesting. Yeah.
But she ends up getting the Phoenix Force after Jean Grey, and she does all this stuff, and she's always been kind of like... quote unquote crazy. So I was like, this is a weird way to go.
Please, Disney Plus, give me back Vincent D'Onofrio. Please.
Yes.
Give him back. I need more.
That's a weird one too.
Yeah. What was the I used to know the name, the person name of Ironheart. I've forgotten.
My mind is blanked also.
But that looks like that's going to be cool. They didn't bring back up Armor Wars, which is interesting. I just realized they've not reaffirmed the the upcoming Armor Wars series.
Odd. Yeah.
Don't know if that means anything. Not going to read into it, but because I'm looking forward to that, because it's a roadie show. I like roadie. But I don't know. Yeah. Guess we're not getting any news about that today.
Not today. They dropped a lot on us already. So, you know, they might just have to let us calm down for a second.
Yeah, maybe they're just like, we don't want to kill them. So we'll hold off a bit. When I first heard that Agatha was getting her own show, I was not thrilled. And, you know, I think I remember saying at the time that it was like, look, I have undying faith in Marvel. I'm sure it'll be good. I'm sure I'll watch it and I'm sure I'll like it. But I'm just not like super excited for it, because I'm a little confused about what it would even be if it's an Agatha show. But for some reason, seeing the title card with the title, House of Harkness, I don't know why. Just seeing that, I was like, all right, I'm in. All right, let's have fun.
Yeah, I really like that. The whole design for that is really nice, I think. House of Harkness. But yeah, I don't know what they're going to do. Is it like a...
Oh, I guess it could be. When I saw House of Harkness, I was like, House of M? House of maybe? No? I hope? I don't know.
I hope so. I love House of M. I don't think you're supposed to like House of M, though. That shit was crazy, you know? But.
Yeah, I'm actually reading House of M for the first time right now.
What?
Yeah, because I there was like a super special event at my local comic book shop, and they had it for like $4. And I was like, oh, I've never read it. I should buy this. So I've been reading it.
Oh man, that's a wild ride.
Yeah, I've never read it before. I'm still in like the beginning parts. That's a lot of Magneto backstory. I think that's pretty cool. Anyway, oh, what else? So they've announced one of the things that were announced today. We had, yeah, the X-Men animated series. So is that meant to be like we're reviving the 90s cartoon, I guess?
I kind of felt like it was going to be a continuation of the 90s cartoon, but I can't really remember how that ended, so
If they're
that's
just
just a stab
continuing,
in the dark.
it's pretty
Yeah.
cool if they're going to try to continue it. I hear the Spider-Man thing is animated. I hope it's Tom Holland. I want more Tom Holland.
I have no idea. I feel like, I mean, because they've been doing these characters for years, so wouldn't you get bored eventually of doing it, even as a voice acting? I feel like I'd get bored.
Yeah, well, I don't feel like I'd get bored. But I'm crazy, and also, money.
Was about to say they get paid buckets of money, so I was like, maybe I won't get bored.
Yeah, I kind of doubt it. You can always get an actor to come back if you back up a dump truck of money, which
You could
I
give
assume
me.
is what they do. I assume that they like show up on Benedict Cumberbatch's lawn with a dump truck full of cash, and
Shit.
Kevin steps out of the driver's seat and says, "All right, Benedict, come
You could get me like that. You could get me to do anything if you
on."
show up with a fucking dump truck of money.
Man, Kevin Feige, mad genius. The dude never stops.
Never. He's always on the move.
I'm impressed. Let's see. Over in other fandoms, we've got the just to mention them, we've got a Baymax series coming next year. I'm
Oh.
so happy that
I didn't know that they were doing that.
Baymax is getting his own show. There's a little trailer. You can go find it. It's cute. Baymax is adorable. Oh God, I love Baymax. Like, I'm just so happy that Baymax is getting his own series. And there's the Obi-Wan series has been kind of reaffirmed for next year. I cannot wait
Oh, nice.
for the
Okay.
Obi-Wan series. I'm so excited. I don't think we've done any Star Wars on this show yet, but we will. We
Ooh,
will.
I'll have to get Chris for that one. She's the big Star Wars fan.
Oh, I'll keep that in mind. I will need a Star Wars friend for this because I don't know if anyone that I'm that I usually oh I've got someone I've but anyway yeah I will keep that in mind because we have not done any Star Wars yet. This is meant to be kind of a it's wound up being mostly Marvel because Marvel is always doing something. It was originally going to be like every week I'm talking about a different fandom and I'm just talking about whatever's going on in that fandom that week. But it just wound up being, here's what happened in Marvel this week.
Well, they keep doing things. They don't give you a second to breathe.
I never get a break, so I just keep doing Marvel. I'm fine with that. I'm totally fine with that. Anyway, yeah. I'm pretty thrilled about all this Disney Plus stuff. I'm thrilled for the future of the Eternals. I'm especially thrilled just because I'm really intrigued with the future of the Black Knight.
Oh, same. I can't wait to see what they do with the Eternals too, because like we said, they split them up. Like the team isn't even the same team anymore.
Yeah, they split them up 3 and 3,
And
right
how
down
is
the middle.
I'm convinced Icarus is coming back. I don't think they're going to kill off three main characters, so I want to,
I'm
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 excited.
intrigued. I'm intrigued to see if that comes true because I thought he died, and
If
I
I'm right
was like,
about that, I'm sorry.
"Yeah, see, because you probably are." So, yeah, because I remember as soon as that happened, like he starts crying and then flies straight up and then he goes into the sun. It goes white and then it goes black. And I turned to my dad, was seeing it with my dad, and I was like, "Is this the darkest Marvel movie? This they had a suicide. This is dark." And it is. It's pretty dark for a Marvel movie.
Yeah, even if he comes back, that was still boring.
Yeah. Oh man, that was intense. All right. I am winded. I am out of things to say. Have you got any closing thoughts?
I don't think so.
All right. Where can people find you on the social medias?
With social media, all I have is Twitter. I run the Twitter for my podcast, and the Twitter is True Believers P. And I have run a podcast with my friend Chris. It's just a comic book podcast, so that is True Believers, a comic book podcast.
All right. Yeah, and if you enjoyed this discussion, dear listener, you can follow us at Fandom Optimists on Twitter. We're also on Facebook, but I don't really use it, so follow us on Twitter. And yeah, tell a friend. We need listeners. Tell a friend if you enjoyed this. And until next time, y'all, never apologize for loving your fandom and try your best to stay optimistic. I'll see you next week.